Fabien is a senior researcher at Inrae, the French National Research Institute for Agriculture, Food and Environment. He's developing bioinformatics methods to study genome-scale metabolic networks, aiming at retrieving parts of the metabolism affected by genetic or environmental perturbations using experimental data such as metabolomics. Fabien is leading the development of the MetExplore web server and coordinating a group of 10 computational biologists. He is the director of MetaboHUB, the French National Infrastructure for Metabolomics and Fluxomics, and is he was president of the French-speaking Metabolomics and Fluxomics Network, RFMF, and is now currently the secretary of the International Metabolomics Society. So thank you very much again, Fabien, and the floor is yours.
So thanks for the introduction, and thanks all the team for the organization and for the invitation, of course. So it's a pleasure to be with you this afternoon, and a bit of pressure when I see the speakers afterwards. Yes, as Marie-France said, so we are located in Toulouse. For those who don't know, it's southwest of France. So you have a picture here. So the city is famous because we put the pieces of the A380 plane together in the city. And like most French cities, you have some food specialties, quite fat ones, in fact. The lab is also on food, but more on the toxicological aspects. So I'm working at Toxalim, and the lab is focusing on xenobiotics, so the compounds that can be transferred to food, and we try to assess if they are risky or not. And in particular, we focus on the compounds that may imply some bad metabolic outcomes. So that's why we focus on metabolism. And in particular, we deal with quite a lot of metabolomics data. So Toulouse and more broadly, as Marie-France mentioned, France is quite established in metabolomics and also fluxomics. So yeah, the idea is to measure metabolism. I will come back to that. So the team is composed of around 10 bioinformaticians, and I am not going to cover all the subjects and the methods we develop. I'm going to focus on some of them. But just to give you an overview, what we mainly do in the lab is, in fact, looking at metabolism in different contexts, so mainly human, for questions of nutrition, diseases, and as I said, exposition to xenobiotics, so for instance, bisphenol A or perfluorated compounds. We have different kind of samples coming in, so data coming from different kind of samples, from cells to biofluids, human biofluids or animal biofluids. And of course, as many of you may be aware, we are not going to be able to do the same kind of modeling depending on the data we get. So here today, I'm going to focus quite a lot on the biofluids data. But when we have more in-depth and broad data, like when we get in vitro data, we can go then up to more modeling and simulations. So the data we get are mainly metabolomics and transcriptomics, but any kind of information that on metabolism will be quite helpful to have more predictive models at the end. And the core of the team is around method development. So I'm going to talk about graph-based algorithms, but we also have some people working on constraint-based modeling. For instance, Nathalie Poupin in the group. And as I will mention, we are now moving also to some data mining approaches. And finally, we do visualization quite a lot. Just some examples that I am not going to detail, but to showcase the fact that we look at other things is we look at biofluids coming in and out of tissues, for instance, in mini pigs, out and in and out of the liver. And using constraint-based modeling, we try to predict what is happening in the liver in the context of, for instance, high-fat diet. So that's with colleagues in Clermont-Ferrand in France. constraint-based modeling and flux modeling is also quite useful if you want to predict drug, potential drug targets. And so we have some project with some colleagues in Toulouse in terms of cancer research and identifying potential drug targets. And finally, what I am going to focus on today is based on the data, try to make sense of this data. So that has been the main focus of the team for a while, but now, as you saw, we have a broader perspective. And and finally, so we are mainly computational scientists, and some of the methods that we develop, we transfer them to MetExplore, which is a web server, which is freely available, and then you can play with the genome scale metabolic networks and your data. Not all the things that I'm going to mention are available through the interface because it requires some extra work, but some of the methods are already available. So just to come to the topic today, I'm going to talk about how we can go from the metabolomics data, the data measuring the metabolism to knowledge, to try and discover new knowledge. Basically, as I said, I will take examples on human health, but you can also imagine that it could be on toxicology, for instance. So we have generally experimental setups where we have control groups and patients, and of course, samples coming from that. And the first question is what is changing in their metabolism when they get a disease? And this is achieved by using metabolomics to identify what we call metabolic profiles. Basically, metabolic profiles are a list of metabolites, let's say a few tens of metabolites which concentration is really changing in a significant way between the control and the patients, if I summarize it in that. So we get a list of metabolites, which is already a good information if you want to do, for instance, biomarker discovery. And then the question after that is, once you have this list, is why these concentrations and why these metabolites especially are changing? So that's where we use the metabolic network. So it gives us a biochemical context to the metabolites that we identified. So we did a lot of work and with Marie-France and other colleagues in terms of developing algorithms to try and make sense of these metabolites in terms of the reactions that could connect these metabolites in metabolism. So I will come back to that, but we have to deal with thousands of reactions and we want to focus on what is really of interest for the interpretation. And what I'm going to present, which is a bit new compared to what we did in the past, is once you have this list of metabolites and reactions, you can also then go into the literature and try to identify what could be the outcomes related to these metabolites. Because you can have some exotic metabolites that you are not aware of, and the literature is definitely the way to find the information. So what we try to do is to develop some computational approaches to once again help in the interpretation of this list of compounds. So the first step, and I guess I will do the introduction for other afterwards also, is how can we transform the information, the knowledge we have on metabolism, so what you can find in your biochemistry books, into computational models and at least databases. So that's maybe a name that will come back in other presentation, and definitely, I guess, is genome scale metabolic networks. So we try to assemble all the information we have on metabolism. So basically we start from one compound, all the reactions that can produce or consume this compound, all the reactions that can then be produced or consumed by these reactions, and so on and so on. So we assemble all the information that you can find on the metabolism into one single network, and then we will do the computation on that. So there are many tools and resources now to allow the reconstruction of these networks based on the genome. So basically we start from the annotation of the genome, we look for genes that code for enzymes, then for the reactions that can be catalyzed by these enzymes, we list all the reactions and that gives a first draft of the metabolic network. I will show you just afterward that it's not the end of the process, then you have to improve the quality of these networks, and it's a really long process. So basically, just to keep in mind that we are focusing on metabolism, the genes related to the metabolism, the proteins related to the metabolism, and of course the metabolites. So these networks, these databases, you can find them in many resources, whether web pages or databases that contains models in, for instance, HTML format. Just to give you an idea, the kind of networks we are dealing with contains thousands of metabolites and reactions. That's the latest reconstruction of human metabolic network. So we need the algorithms to deal with these complex structures. And as I said, so this is a work done with Mike and Fred that we'll talk afterwards, and by Sanou Shamir, a former PhD student in the group. We did this reconstruction on Trypanosoma brucei, which is the parasite responsible of sleeping sickness. And here you have some important dates showing that it takes a while to have a good reconstruction. It takes a lot of people, so 40 experts were gathered to work on that. And we did a lot of changes on the first draft of the reconstruction. So it's a lot of work, but once we have a good model, then we can move to better prediction. So it's an important step and important to keep in mind that these models are always being developed. So yeah, something that I mentioned already, but I will make the difference between the pathways, which are quite useful, the metabolic pathways, because they are quite oriented toward functions, but they give a really fragmented point of view on metabolism and not a systemic point of view on metabolism. So here you have, for instance, the glycolytic metabolic pathways for human. But if you look in the human metabolic network in KEG, for instance, in green here, you have this metabolic pathway. And in fact, all the metabolites in this pathway can be, not all, most of them, can be consumed or produced by reactions that belong to other pathways. So we need, if we want to have, if we have global and targeted data like metabolomics, we may want to consider the whole system and not only the pathway. So yeah, that's what we are dealing with. So once we have the network and we are able to map the metabolomics data, so let's say the few tens of metabolites that we get into the networks, the question is afterwards to try and see how these metabolites are connected, which reactions are connecting these metabolites. And that's where we need some algorithms to help, because as I said, we have thousands of nodes and edges in the network. So I will take, in the presentation, two examples that come from the same groups or consortium. Groups that are working on brain diseases, and the first one is CAFSA disease. So mainly it's rare diseases, and that leads to a really complex syndrome. So the data we got comes from CSF samples, so cerebrospinal fluids, which is the fluid where the brain is located. And so we get a list of metabolites from that. So that's the list. So these metabolites are, as I said, significantly different between the control group and the patients who got the disease. And that's the starting point for us. So we have this list. So you see it's like 30 or something metabolites, and the network contains thousands of metabolites. So what we're going to try and do is to find path between these metabolites. So sequences of reactions that can go from one metabolite to the other. If I take a really toy example, let's say you have glucose and pyruvate, and what you want the algorithm to do is to be able to give you an idea about the path, the more likely path between glucose and pyruvate. So here is the glycolysis, for instance. So yeah, that's the aim of the algorithm. It sounds like an easy question when you come from graph modeling, but what we face when we try to apply graph algorithms to metabolic networks is that they have the specificity of having a lot of compounds that are called side compounds or cofactors, for instance, ADP or ATP that are proton donors and not really the main focus of a specific reaction. So for instance, if you do the shortest pass in a metabolic network between glucose and pyruvate, what you will get is glucose, glucokinase, ADP, pyruvate, kinase, and pyruvate. Typically, that's not what we want to find out. We want to find the glycolysis. And one of the reasons we are going to find this pass is that ADP, ATP, and this kind of compounds, they are hubs in the network. They are kind of shortcuts. So there are plenty of ways to avoid this shortcut. The way we are using now is the one I'm going to explain now. If you look at a specific reaction, so let's say you are doing your path search and you reach glucose, and you have to make the decision whether the next step is going to be glucose 6-phosphate or ADP. So the algorithm has to decide that. And remember, we have 7,000 reactions, so we have thousands of reactions, and so it has to be automatic. So yes, if you look at the reactions and more particularly at the molecules, what you can do is then look at the atoms and where the atom of glucose are going in the products. So for instance, all the carbons that belong to glucose will go in glucose 6-phosphate. So what we did is it's a bit basic, but since we mainly focus on carbon transfer, what we do is that we are going to put weight on the edges that corresponds to the number of carbons that are transferred in the reaction between a substrate and the product. And here you realize that zero carbons are transferred to ADP. And then what we do is once again really basic. We are going to remove all the edges with a zero weight, meaning that there is no carbon transfer. So we change the graph that we got at the beginning to get a better topology. And what we realized is that this topology is really better in terms of results when we do, for instance, path search. And so that's the way we are doing that. Remember, we have to do that at the on the thousands of reactions. We are using a tool which is called the RDT to compute this atom mapping between the substrate and the product. So the things I'm going to show afterwards are computations that are based on this topology. So then now we have a reliable topology, and then we can look at how the metabolites are connected. One first question is, when we have a list of metabolites, do they belong to the same part of metabolism? So for instance, if we think about complex syndromes, like the brain disease I was talking about, maybe it's a different part of the metabolism that are affected by the disease. So maybe the metabolites are in different part of metabolism, or it could be that it's really one subpart of metabolism which is affected. So that's one question. But since now we are able to compute path between metabolites, we can also compute distances between metabolites. And if we do clusters on this distance matrix, we can then easily identify which set of metabolites are close to each other in the network. So in practice, if I come back to my list of metabolites that I showed you, when you look at your metabolites and here the color corresponds to the distance in the network between two metabolites. So the more it is red, the closer they are in the network. And if it's really almost white, they are really far away in the network. So here already you start to have a structure in your list of metabolites, which corresponds to this cluster here. So these metabolites here, they are really close. And in fact, it's only a two or three step to go from one to the other. And so once you have that, you can start and stratify your analysis of your list of metabolites and maybe focusing on clusters more than on the whole list to understand different parts of metabolism. And in fact, if you look at the reactions that allows to connect these metabolites, you can quickly get this subnetwork. So remember, we had 7,000 reactions at the beginning, and now, automatically, we can have this subnetwork. So the red metabolites here, the red circles correspond to the metabolites that were in the metabolic profiles, and the other ones are in between these metabolites. And what you can see also on this picture is the color of the edges correspond to the different pathways, and you see that these metabolites, they don't belong to the same pathway. So once again, it's important to consider the system that may span several pathways. So here we have a good subnetwork, and already it helped the colleagues to better characterize the metabolism. But also what you can see is that there are some metabolites that are not in the original fingerprint, in the original list of metabolites. But what we realize is that these metabolites could be also of interest. So the idea we had afterwards was to create an algorithm that was going to be able to suggest metabolite based on the list of metabolites you have as an input. So this is inspired, and I will come back to that, from recommendation systems. And the idea is to improve the list of metabolites that we can get from an experiment by using the network. So this is another list of metabolites, which again come from CSF. So HE is hepatic encephalopathy. So it's another brain disease. And once again, we got 30 relevant metabolites that were different between the control and the patients. One of the limits we have when we do metabolomics is that we are not going to be able to measure all the metabolites for a really large range of reasons. One of the reasons is that if you look here, this is for human metabolic network. Only 30% of the metabolites in the human metabolic network in RECON2 model, you will be able in metabolomics, in mass spectrometry, to be able to identify them at the highest level of certainty. So it means that using LC-MS, you are not going to be able to measure all metabolites, but maybe some of these metabolites that are not measured are of interest. Also, you can have a really fast turnover, so the metabolites are consumed and produced really quickly. Or they can have concentrations that are too low, and so on and so on. So there are plenty of reasons that you can miss some metabolites in your fingerprint, and the idea was to fill these gaps with the algorithm. So as I said, the algorithm is inspired from recommendation systems. So basically now the media provider and the social networks, what they want to do is not to give you information, but recommendations. So if you go on any of them, they will have a system to give you some, to point you some things that could be of interest for you. And basically we transfer this ID to metabolic networks. So the algorithm that we developed is inspired by PageRank algorithm. So the PageRank come from Larry Page, who is one of the two founders of Google. And that's the first algorithms they used to rank the web pages. The idea behind that and the algorithms behind that is what is called random walks. So the idea of random walks is also called the drunken guy problem. So you imagine you have a map of a city with the different corner of the city and the roads between the corners, and you want to know what are the most important corners in the city. So what the algorithm is going to do is going to simulate thousands of drunk guys that come back home. They move randomly because they are drunk, and you are going to count how many times they go through a corner, and then all these random walks, they may go always, or no, not always, but most of the time through the same corners, and it gives you what corners are important in the graph. So you can have many of analogies for that, but this is basically the idea of algorithm. So if you do that on the whole network, let's say you go on Twitter, you get the social network of Twitter, and you do that on the whole network, what you will get is just almost the highly connected nodes. So for instance, Justin Bieber's many followers. So at the end, you will get this guy because all the paths will go through this guy. So what the algorithms are doing is that they do what we call personalized page rank. The random walks are not going to start from any point in the network. They are going to start from the points that are of interest for you. So they are not going to spread all the network. They will stay in the area where your interest is. So basically, that's what we did, but with the metabolites. So the idea behind that is if you do that, you're going to have something which is maybe a bit more of interest for you. So for instance, for me, it's going to be a Barrett lab. We can say it's a kind of the Justin Bieber of biochemistry, but you will see that after me, I think. So we turned the method and applied it to metabolic networks. So there are a few practical changes that are behind that. It's not that straightforward. But basically, we start from metabolites that are identified as in the fingerprint, and we follow the reactions. And so we're gonna follow the reactions and then see which metabolites are, let's say, after a lot of the metabolites in the fingerprint. And we do that also the other way around. We start from the metabolites and we go backward upstream of the reactions. The idea behind that is that the metabolite could also be the outcome of something which is going upstream in the brain, for instance, in our example. So we have two measures, in fact. The important metabolites downstream and the important metabolites upstream. So we have a combination of two measures. And here it is the result on the list of metabolites that we got on the 30 metabolites. So then you can rank all the other metabolites in the network based on their importance. So for instance, this metabolite here was not in the original list, but based on the topology, it seems it is important. So you can then start, and among the thousands of metabolites, you can start with the one which seems to be most important. So this is an example of metabolite that was not in the original list, but that was suggested by the algorithm in the top metabolites. So kynurenic acid, one of the reasons it was discarded from the original list is that the variation was a bit too high between the patients. But if you go back to the raw data and you go back and see that, you realize that the control are quite homogeneous for this compound. And even if it's on the edge of being significant, it could be of interest to consider this metabolite in the picture. So this is often one of the reasons that we remove metabolites from a metabolic fingerprint, because we consider that they are not significant, but if they are at the edge of being significant, it could be of interest to put them back. This is a bunch of other examples. So the blue metabolites, the orange metabolites, sorry, were in the original profile, and the algorithm is suggesting all the blue ones. And in fact, the blue ones are allowing to fill the gaps between them. And if we go back to the literature, for instance, for this one, the 2-oxoglutaramate, we then realized that it was making sense to put it back, at least for the interpretation, and maybe also go back to the raw data and try to identify this metabolite in the raw data, in the metabolomics raw data. So just to summarize that part, we got a list of 30 metabolites. We applied the algorithm on the metabolic network. So we have 2,600 metabolites. We ranked them. We kept the 40 top metabolites and we gave them back to the colleagues who are doing the metabolomics. They get back to the raw data. They did some identification and so on. And based on that, they were confident and added 9 new metabolites to the original list. So by increasing the list, as I said, you can improve your interpretation of the data, but you can also discover potential other biomarkers than the one that you are used to look at. So basically, you improve your metabolic profiling. So you are then able, coming back to what I showed you before, you can go back to the identification of modulated subnetworks. So then the question is, we have this list of metabolites. We all can also have some pathways or some networks that are moving. But then the final question I'm going to discuss is, can we make some biomedical meanings behind that? And to do that, we are going to use what we call knowledge graphs. So this is a collaborative work, but mainly done by a PhD student in the group, Maxime Delmas, and supervised by Clément Freinet. So the idea is to link metabolites with biomedical information using the literature. So if you go to the literature, and for instance, once again, I will take a really basic example. You want to connect glucose and diabetes. You will find this information in the literature. And the good thing is that also, for instance, using PubMed, you will have access to more detailed information, at least a structured and organized information about what papers are talking about. So for instance, for each paper, you will be able to find what we call mesh terms that are ontological terms describing the biomedical concepts. And with each paper, you will also have a list of compounds that are mentioned in the paper. So the idea is to gather this information for all the literature and then to use it to make the connection between these concepts and the compounds. And what we are going to do is to build a knowledge graph. A knowledge graph is a graph where you have different kind of nodes that correspond to different elements of information and which are connected by ontological relationship. I will give you an example just afterwards. So we are going to build this network. And the advantage of building this network is that then you can start and answer complex questions. So I'm going to take an example that will ring a bell for French people, but maybe not for the people from abroad. So this guy here is a French singer. So if you don't know French music, I wouldn't suggest to start with Carlos. Maybe there are better ones. But this guy has a specificity, is that his mother was really famous and a really famous writer. So if you ask this question to Google, what are the books written by the mother of Carlos? This is not a straightforward question. By looking at him, you are not going to be able to answer that. What you have to know is that this guy is the son of somebody, in fact, Françoise Dolto, who is a famous writer, and that this famous writer wrote a list of books. So this is basically what we have in knowledge graphs. We have different kind of piece of information and then relationships that explains how they are related. So for instance, we have this guy is the son of this person who is the author of these books. And once again, that's what Google is using. So if you Google that, it will give you the list of books. So it's not obvious because this guy doesn't have the same name as his mother. So it's not a question of naming or whatever. They really use these connections to be able to make this complex answer. So this is a toy example, but that's what we want to do between molecules and diseases, for instance. So what Maxime Clément did is that they encoded that in a service which is called Forum. So for molecules, what we're going to have is the molecule itself, but then some information. For instance, the molecular weight of glucose is this one. You can have some identifiers. You can have information about other conformation of the molecule. And then you can also have information about the classes of this molecule, the fact that this is at the end a monosaccharide. And on the other hand, you can gather in this knowledge graph, the fact that glucose is discussed in a specific paper, which title is that and date of publication is that. And then since you have the mesh terms, you can find that the topic of this paper is diabetes. And you can have broader descriptors that says that diabetes is itself a glucose metabolism disorder. So you can have then, if you, since you have a graph, you can then go through the graphs and make connection, more complex connection between, for instance, monosaccharides and glucose metabolic disorders, connections that were not obvious at the beginning. So they did that. They gathered information using PubMed, PubChem, Mesh, and KB, and other resources. So here you have the numbers of information that you have to gather. So it's these knowledge graphs, they are large to build. So it takes 1 week, something like that, to build them. But once you have them, then you have some really strong engine to work on them. So one of the advantages when you manage to have information on these diseases and compounds is that then you are able to see if there is a statistical relationship between these compounds. So basically, you can use the network to compute relevant associations between disease and compounds. So as I said, for papers in PubMed, you can get the list of compounds mentioned in the papers. For papers in PubMed, you can get the list of concepts that are discussed in these papers. And then what you do is basically you're going to do an enrichment analysis. You are going to see if the association of a compound and the concept is significant in the literature. So if you look at glucose and diabetes, you will realize that they are often they are really often mentioned together. So you can create new connections in your graph. So in your graph, you will be able to say that glucose is not only associated to that, but to other level in the knowledge, but also to other diseases. So if you compute all the possible relations that you have in this database between biochemical concept and molecules, you have 80 millions. Among these 80 millions, almost 9 million are significant in terms of enrichment. And among these 9 million, 1 million are connecting really molecules and diseases. So these 1 million associations are of interest, because then if you can ask, okay, I'm working on this compound, I want to know all the diseases that are significantly mentioned in the literature with this compound, you can look for that. And so what they design is this small web interface where you can give a compound and it will give you back a list of biomedical concept associated to this compound. So here, for instance, if you put in a cyclic AMP, it will give you this list of mesh terms, and you can then among the mesh terms focus on diseases, and so it will give you the list of more highly likely diseases associated to this specific compound. What they implemented also is the score, which is a test which is called the weakness index, which is saying whether when you are on the edge of being significant in terms of number of papers. So how many papers do you need to be sure at least confident that this is a good relationship between the molecule and the disease. So this is a simple one-to-one association that you are testing. But you can go further, but then you need some advanced, it's more a question of computation. So what they provide is also what we call the Sparkle endpoint, which is a kind of access to this complex resource database. So you can access this database and do some queries on it, and then you can represent the result of the query. For instance, here I have a compound, and using the query, I am able to see all the concepts that are related to this compound in terms of mesh terms. So it's not huge. It's a good starting point to browse the topic that are related to a molecule. You can also go further, and that's really the ultimate goal, is to not look at one compound, but for instance, these two compounds and all the concepts, topics that are related to these compounds, and these topics in between they could be of interest because they are related to these two compounds. So really, this is our next step. Here I focused on the link between one compound and the potential diseases. Now the idea is to look at a list of compounds and to narrow down the potential outcomes in a way like that. So that's what we plan to do in the next future. So to conclude, I don't know if I am in time.
Yes, just time to wrap up.
Yeah, so so to conclude, I asked a few questions at the beginning. So what are the changes in metabolism? So the metabolomics is clearly a good way to look at the metabolism because it's really close to the phenotype. And the point is that using metabolic networks, metabolic models, you can improve this profiling and this list of metabolites. So there is really what we want to set up with the metabolomics people is a circle where they give us a list, we do suggestions using the network, they improve their list and so on and so on, just to get the best picture as possible of metabolism. The next question is, why is it changing? So the graphs is a good starting point to make this kind of identification of subnetworks. So I presented the past search algorithm, but with Marie-France and the colleagues, we did another approach, which was metabolic stories. So there are plenty of ways to extract some networks. Once again, it depends on your data and the kind of questions you ask. But there are really a nice way to do that. Then the next question is, we see things changing and will it result in a bad outcome or does it correspond to a potential disease? And that's where we can use the knowledge graph and the data mining approach. So there are plenty of challenges, of course, and I think some of them will be discussed in the next presentations. Specific to metabolomics, there are some metabolites that we are not able to identify surely. So what we try to do in the group, so Elva in the group, for instance, is developing a multi-layer networks approaches where we want to use different kind of metabolomics-based network to improve the analysis. Of course, the integration with other omics data, we do that with transcriptomics, but you can also use the clinical data and physiological data. Once you have the subnetwork, it's only the beginning. And then I think it's quite complementary to give ideas for flux computation afterwards. And of course, this is really static what I presented. The flux are really more advanced, but you need more, of course, more parameters and data. The integration of other networks it will be key in the future. It's already starting, but for instance, including the regulation is quite important. In terms of knowledge graph, we know that there are associations between molecules and diseases, but we don't know the type of the association. If it's a molecule mentioned because it's a drug or because it's a biomarker. So now the idea, and we are working on text mining to be able to qualify this association. And finally, this is dealing with complex systems, and there will be talk, I think, about gut microbiota, but definitely we have to integrate the systems and the metabolites. And the final remark is, what we realize, so we are located in the wet lab, is we always have to go back to the experts, and what we do using modeling is providing suggestions, and not, to my mind, my personal point of view is that we don't give answers, but we try to narrow down the options for the biologists. So we have to keep that in mind, that the model is never perfect. So yeah, that's thanks again, Marie-France, Ariel, Sarah, and Susanna for the invitation. This is the current group. We will have a position available for genome scale modeling that I didn't mention too much. So drop me a line if you are interested. So thanks.
Thank you very much, Fabien, for this beautiful talk. And we are open for some questions. We already have some in the chat. The first one is, what would be a metabolite? This, I don't understand. I think I don't understand the question. Maybe you can see, or the question can be reformulated in a more clear way, in a more specific way.
So maybe to precise, in metabolomics, what we consider a metabolite is the low weight molecule. So you below 1,500 daltons will be considered as a metabolite. So it's small molecules in general.
Okay, the next question is, what programs would you recommend to perform gap fill analysis during metabolic model evaluation stage?
During the reconstruction process, or if it's about the reconstruction process, I am a bit outdated in terms of the right tools. We were using the pathway tools, which is doing some gap filling. I guess in the Cobra toolbox also, you will have some options for that. Now more and more people are using a MEMOT system for reconstruction. So yeah, there are quite a few outside. We were using the pathway tools, but you can have other options.
Excellent. There is another one here. It is how do you deal with cycles and highly connected metabolites like cofactors in the metabolic networks?
So yeah, that's what I try to show is that in fact they are when you think in terms of graphs. I'm not talking about stoichiometric matrix, but a graph. You want to avoid them, and the way we do that is by removing edges that are going to them. We don't remove them from the network because they can be of interest, and it's really hard to say in a subjective manner they have to be removed. So we don't remove them, but we remove the edges that goes to them and we feel they are not of interest. So the way we do that is, as I said, is when there is no carbon transfer between this specific compound and another one, we don't put the edge. And so in that way, you reduce the connectivity of these compounds and you also discard some potential bypass.
Perfect. There is a question that, in fact, are more than one, but I think that it is interesting. Is it possible to use transcriptomics to the metabolites to reduce your search space and identify metabolites that are not occurring in the metabolomics data per se? This is the first one.
Yeah. So that's a good question, and there is, in fact, a large range of approaches to do that. So in Marie-France group and in our group and many other ones, we are developing what we call the tissue or cell-specific metabolic network. So you start with the human metabolic network, let's say RECON, for instance, the one I showed you. You get the transcriptomic data of a specific cell type. And what you're going to do is to try and keep only the reactions for which you have active transcripts, and then you are going to fill the gaps with algorithms. So basically, to summarize, you take the transcriptomic data and the generic network, and you remove reactions that seems not to be active. So you reduce the network. And once you reduce the networks, of course, you reduce the metabolites, the metabolites in your list. So that's one way to do. And it has been proven that it's more efficient than when you first do that and then you do your flux analysis, because you have something, a model which is more adapted to your cells or tissues. For metabolomics, it's not that used, but it could be, yes.
Okay, and the second part of the same question is, how does it compare to your method of algorithmically identifying missing metabolites?
I mean, it's I think it's the same. I mean, our method is not discarding metabolites. So when I was talking, if it's okay. About metabolank, we are ranking all the metabolites. We just give them a score. We could do that on the sub network, and it would change, in fact, the metabolank. So let's say if you have a list of metabolites and you do that on the generic network or on the tissue specific network, you're going to reach two different metabolank results. And yes, it's true that maybe it may have some impact on the metabolank that we use. That's where I see the complementarity. For me, it's two different things. Not sure I answered well. But...
Perfect. There are several other questions, but I will make to you the last ones, and the rest will be transmitted to you as a file, okay? And then eventually you can reply to the people. But the next one is, what kind of threshold do you use to decide if a chemical compound and the disease are associated or not? I suppose it is referring to the last part of your talk.
Yeah, so there is a it's a good question. So it's a hypergeometric test. So you're gonna have a Q value at the end. So you I don't remember. So the value the result of this test is available in the web interface. But I don't remember which value they use, which is likely to be 0.05 or 0.01, but you can change that since you get all the raw data. So you can do your own filter and select when you want to stop. In fact, when we look at the results in practice, the values are really, really, they are really highly significant, far from 0.05, sorry. So yeah, you can select your own. That's the point.
Perfect. Another question, in fact, there are two together, is the first one is whether metabolite data to run is, sorry, first question is whether metabolite data to run the modeling should also come from NMR instead of MS.
Yeah, so it's possible. You can also have the two at the same time. The NMR is quite efficient in terms of reproducibility and quantification and things like that. The issue is that in terms of variety of metabolites, it's a bit less broad, let's say, because in the sensibility of NMR is lower, so you tend to have, not always, but metabolites that are close to each other. So
okay.
Yeah, it's less diverse. So the it's a bit more difficult in terms of mechanistic interpretation.
Okay. The other question by the same person is, which approach can be used to integrate metabolomic and quantitative proteomics data to have a better understanding of a specific condition?
I'm talking only about the graphs, for instance. They could be considered as nodes if we use, for instance, a bipartite model where we have the reaction. So you can transfer the information on the reaction, and then you can use that to as a parameter on your graph algorithm. So that could be one way. So for instance, if I take my random walk example, you could say that where you have highly expressed proteins, it's more likely that the path is going through this node, so through this reaction. So that could be a way to use the data. Mm-hmm. And of course, if you have more information in terms of information, then you can use that for flux modeling. But that's another question, and you need more data for that.
Perfect. Another one, we have still time for one or two. Here it says, I would like to ask about the subnetwork extraction. Specifically, you mentioned shortest path distances on the modified metabolomic network as a way to cluster metabolites and extract to subnetworks. But I am wondering how one would extract such subnetwork that are functional, such that each reaction can carry flux in flux balance.
That's a good question, and I think that could be that's
really good. It requires another talk.
Yes, I think so. Maybe some brainstorming, because here now I don't know how to do that, but that's true that we should consider also potentially the stoichiometry. The challenge there is when you want to select a pass, if it's doable in terms of stoichiometry, you need to have information on if the cofactors are available of all the reactions in between. So you're gonna define the pass, and what you want to check is that the flux is doable through this pass. But to know if it's doable, you need to know if the side compounds are available in the medium or in the cell to be able to do that. So it's not obvious. And I think that's why we start with the graphs. And that's one of the limits of the subnetwork that I showed, is that we don't check this. We don't check that. And that's true that we could have a suggestion which is proposing a path that is not feasible in terms of stoichiometry. But it's hard to be checked, I think.
I will do two more that, if you can answer very quickly. One is, can you describe how you can be sure of manual curation without dynamic or flux balance analysis approaches?
Of the curation of the metabolic network?
Well, it is not. Yeah. I suppose yes, but yeah, it is not mentioned in the question.
Yeah, but in fact, in the... I didn't show that, but in the protocol of building a metabolic network, you are going to check that. I mean, you are going to check that the metabolic network that you build is able to produce at least some biomass. You are going to check some metabolic functions. There are in the reconstruction process. It's not only listing reactions, I focused on that, but it's also using some constraint-based modeling to check that your network is fulfilling some metabolic functions. And yeah, coming back to the previous question, I realized also that one way to do is also to use the elementary flux modes. That could be a way to prune the list of reactions. I mean, the list of the network. So yeah, that could be also an option.
Perfect. And the last question, the rest of commentaries we will pass to you afterwards. The last question is regarding the identification of interesting metabolites based on computational analysis of subnetworks. And maybe are underrepresented in the metabolomic analysis. Did you make an analysis to evaluate them as diagnostic markers, marker metabolites?
I'm not sure I will answer well. We didn't, as far as I know, they didn't use for now the list of metabolites for biomarker discovery. So it was mainly for understanding the disease and not yet to use a CSF sample and say you have the disease or you don't, or to stratify the patients. So it was not used in this direction for now. It is the ultimate goal, but be sure a metabolite is a biomarker, you have to confirm that in another cohort and so on. It's a more complex process.
Thank you very much, Fabien. Thank you for your beautiful talk.